Der Nummer 1 US-Serien-Hit Vikings als Deutschland-Premiere. Exklusiv nur bei Love Film. Jetzt einfach online oder via App streamen. Auch schon im 30-Tage-Test.
These people went through so many changes. What's the biggest thing they'll be grappling with in season two?
Their fate. In season one, I guess of any show, you're establishing characters. You're finding out as a writer, I guess, and then as an actor, you're discovering who this person is. You're beginning to explore them and their possibilities. By season two, we know a lot more about who our characters are, who the people are, just as our audience does. And so there's a lot more kind of freedom that gives us. And I think what happens in season two is that all of the major characters have to make huge choices and huge sacrifices. And they realize that whatever dreams they have, whatever expectations they have, will involve some sacrifices, sometimes terrible sacrifices. So, of course, it's season two of an established show. It has to get bigger and better. It does get bigger and better. The stakes get higher. The armies get bigger. There are more boats. There's more at stake. We're going to watch Ragnar Lothbrok's continuous rise, which is not, of course, without huge issues around it. So it's going to be a great ride for everyone. It was great. Right for me to write it. It still is. I'm still in the middle of doing that. I'm pushing and pushing all the characters as much as I can, sometimes into areas that are difficult for everyone. These are Vikings. These are not you and me. They sometimes do things that we wouldn't do. They're capable of doing things that we're not capable of doing, and they sometimes make choices which are terrible choices. But I have to tell you that we have one of the best casts I've ever worked with. We have the best cast I've ever worked with.
And I think, Travis, that probably everyone in this room has this question for you. How could Ragnar cheat on Lagertha? Yeah. I know, right? How can you, Ragnar? I want to know.
First off, thank you all for coming and supporting us. I'm a bit nervous tonight because I'm sitting next to her. Why did I cheat on her? Well, I have no clue. It was in the script. Not a chance in the world I'm gonna do that. No, but that's funny. You have no problem with me wanting to sleep with Athelstan. As soon as I say a pretty princess, I'm the bad guy. But no, we tried to have kids prior to this, and I felt like my character thought it was a sign from the gods that we lost a baby. And I think Ragnar's all about his legacy. He wants as many kids as he can get, and wants them to be proud of him and follow in his footsteps. And I think that's the main reason of it. It was certainly hard for him to do it.
Yeah, I mean, look at her. You don't need anyone else. Now, we also have some fan questions mixed in, and This came from Facebook. This is from Fagan Forum from Massachusetts. So this is for Catherine. How will Lagartha respond to Ragnar's infidelity? She's an incredibly strong woman, but seems to love him deeply. I think she needs to kick some serious...
She has her own brother.
Hey, oh, wait.
No, I think Lagartha obviously has always been and probably will always will be in love with Ragnar. And I think you'll have to wait and see how she ends up finding out the news in season two. I do know it was hard for her, but I guess sense of identity would be tested, and it would be interesting to see how these circumstances makes her a better person or a different person in one way or another, especially since her whole life has been attached to Ragnar as farmers, as earls, so as the shield maiden. So it would be interesting to see how she deals and how she struggles with her own, who she is as a person.
Okay. We cannot wait to see that.
Thank you.
I do think she's probably going to kick some ass.
Yeah.
So Clive, we know that Rollo is going to fight against his brother, but brothers know a lot of things about each other. So what is Ragnar's greatest weakness, and how can Rollo exploit that?
One man's weakness is another man's strength. And I think that brothers are two sides to the same coin. So the question really is, I think, Ragnar's very much like a tornado. He's mercurial in the world. Whereas Rollo's more like a volcano. He's volatile and, you know, on edge and can erupt at any time. So the question is, what happens when a tornado meets a volcano? There's going to be a lot of people in the middle there.
I don't think that was the question.
But I don't think it's about exploiting weaknesses. I think it's just come to a point where Rollo can't be in his brother's shadow anymore. And there's only one choice to make in Rollo's eyes. But it's going to have a detrimental effect. It's going to have a negative impact on many characters in the show. And some people aren't going to come out of it, you know, as happy. But, you kind of think you want to know, but you don't. You're going to have to wait and see.
We'll just get a lot of wind-blown lava.
You might learn a little bit from the little clip we're going to show you.
Oh yeah, the clip. We'll get to that. So Jessalyn, Siggy has had probably the most tragic season of any character. She's lost her husband, her children, her position in society, but yet she seems like someone who really does have this strong sense of self and direction. So what direction does that take in season two?
Well, sadly, the decline continues. But it's good because there's just more ground to cover when I come back. The way I think of her is, I guess the way we described her. I mean, she has an identity that's independent of, or maybe that was formed by her family, but that still exists in the absence of her family. And I think she comes from a tribe that was, she really believes was the legitimate regime. And so, she has an incredible drive to, in my eyes, I'm not going to speak for Michael, I can really only speak as an actor, but the way I think of it is, you know, I want to get back up on that chair. So I'm going to do whatever I have to do to get up there.
Oh.
And I mean whatever I do.
We cannot wait to see that. Gustav, there's really no other character. There's no one else like Loki on TV, right? No one. How much like Loki are you? How much do you bring to that role?
Not enough. I hope I'm not as fucking crazy. Fucking close. Well, Floki, I mean, it's It's an incredible character to play. It's so fun to play because the freer I am in the character, the better it gets. Because he is a free spirit, he's nuts. So it's just a matter of like, you know, giving the inner ball a good spin and then kind of like letting go of all social barriers that I had in my mind and just fucking go for it. And it's fun, you know? So yeah.
Fun to wear that eyeliner. Does that help you?
Huh?
The eyeliner, Loki's eyeliner, does that help you?
Yeah, it does help a bit. I like the old guy liner. Me and Tom McDonough, who's the makeup artist, a brilliant guy, we were kind of like working out in the beginning, how are we going to set this character? And it's true, like, they actually did use black, you know, eye makeup back in those days, so it's not like something we made up. And then we just took it, you know, a bit further. And yeah, that's fun. It's trademark.
Well, people are wondering how much of a Viking Athelstan will become, George. Maybe we'll see him in eyeliner, maybe not. But we have a fan question. This is from Alice and Isabel. And she says, do you think Athelstan would ever become a full Viking? Or would he always carry ties to his past as a monk? So what's your take on that, George?
Sorry, I just want to say one thing that I want. George is dating somebody, one of the actresses.
That's up to him if he wants to say it.
Travis, George and I are keeping that a secret. It's okay, baby, go ahead.
Ever become a full Viking?
Well...
Stunt monk!
No, like... like Michael said, the characters, all of the characters in season two have really difficult choices to make, and I can say that I'd be quite disappointed if it was very easy for Athelstan to become completely Viking, and I'm glad that Michael has taken the writing way he has done to a place where Athelstan has to make some really, really difficult choices. And the most interesting characters to play are ones with deep conflicts within them, and I'm just pleased that Michael has decided to carry that on. And so, yeah, the answer is it's gonna be difficult, very difficult for him to make that decision.
Yeah, it's a pretty tempting world, isn't it? The Viking world.
It is.
Yeah.
It is, but he's a very religious man.
Okay, we'll see. So, Dirk, history got into the scripted world with Hatfields and McCoys, and now your first series, Vikings, is shooting season two. These guys all flew in from shooting to see you guys today. Unexpected thing for you about the series Vikings?
I'd have to say that the most unexpected thing for me is this room full of people. We've had lots of shows that do, you know, really good ratings, but never really at this kind of level of engagement from you know, this passionate viewer. And it's not just here at Comic-Con, it's like on Facebook and Instagram and Twitter, and you know, I'm following all these things and just, I can't believe it's not just, you know, talking about the show, but they're engaging with the real history and they're discussing it and debating it. And there's fan art, and we have very active, there's a somebody on Facebook who goes by Viking Drummer. Oh, there she is!
Yeah.
does like recaps of the episodes, and people, you know, are now like following her. You know, I've personally never been involved with something that has this amount of energy and interest and depth of passion around it. And I just want to thank you all. I'm just blown away by it.
About the entire era, beyond what we're seeing the show, which is amazing.
Absolutely. I mean, one of the things that we thought, you know, we had an opportunity to do in doing these scripted dramas is bring interest, you know, through this entertainment, you know, piece to the subject of history. And I'm watching that happen. And some of the things we're posting on the Facebook page are like artifacts, you know, things that have been discovered, archaeological finds, or things that are Viking related, and you know, while we're making a fictional sort of, you know, story, the authenticity is there, and the research, and how much effort goes into, you know, the costumes and the boat building and the homes, you know, it's that bringing that interest potentially up to the subject of history to a new generation of people, I think, is an exciting thing.
Right. Well, yeah, Michael. Yes, you've been working with these Norse myths, you've been adapting the story. And something that is really important in the original Ragnar stories is the story of his sons, the story of his children. And some casting news has come out of Churla. You guys have seen it, that Alexander Ludwig is going to be cast as Bjorn for season 2. Tell me about the children in the show and why casting with them is so important.
As Americans, you like to say that family comes first, or that the family is essentially important in your lives, and it was the same is true for Vikings. And the Vikings, the whole families fought in the Shield War together. They lived and died together. And it was one of the things that I wanted to say about them, one of the things that humanized them, one of the things that made it possible for me to make them the central characters of this drama, that they were like you and me in a lot of ways. Ragnar's, the historical Ragnar, is famous because one of the reasons was because of his own exploits and his own discoveries and daring and so on, but he bred a lot of sons, and his sons became very famous in their turn. When Ragnar died, finally his sons declared war on the whole world, which is a rather wonderful thing, I think. But one of the things that was important to me was that this is a story which is about adventure, and it's about battles, and it's about visceral things. It's also about families. It's about family life. We started out by seeing a Ragnar with his family. And it's very important to me as a writer to embed the audience in the family life of the characters. So it's important for me that the audience got to know Ragnar's children and got to care about Ragnar's children and follow them through. Now, the problem, I suppose, as a writer is that he had a lot of children you can't spend 9 months every time, gestating each one. However, it's a writer, but I think you'll agree that Bjorn, Ragnar Legolas's son in the first season, was beautifully played and wonderful character, and you could identify with him. So he certainly wasn't going to go away. Now Alexander's going to play an older Bjorn. The historical Bjorn was very important character too, but it's the family dynamics which are very much at the
at the heart of the show, the rivalry between the brothers is very natural, it's human. The sons and daughters and the tragedies and joys of a family life, which, as I said, humanized the show for me. And I love, I don't know, it just makes it this great thing for me about the show is it's about reality. It's not a documentary, but it's about real things, for a start, things that actually happen. And it's about real people and human emotions. They just happen to be dressed up as Vikings. So the children are always as important to me as the adult actors.
Well, we also see a lot of pagan rituals in the show. The rituals really take us into this world. So, Travis, we have a fan question for you from Julia Novella. And she says, in episode 9, why did Ragnar cut his hand and wipe the blood along the wall? And you remember, you guys, he was lying in bed and he had the dagger and he cut his hand and he said, Odin. So, tell us about that. Why did he do that?
It's not that it was a ritual. I think it was a lot of suffering. Yeah, what did that have to do? And only sort of punishing himself.
You need to go.
To cut himself. Yeah, to go.
Go ahead.
You did it.
Own it.
Leia. No. Yeah, he was certainly upset about what he's doing, but he thought he was doing all right for him. No, I really thought he was doing the right thing, but he still hated himself for doing it. And I think the blood on the wall was had something to do with the miscarriage, you know, sort of symbolizing that. And it probably something to do with what she'll do to me when I get home.
You're so dead. Yeah.
It's like,
well, I mean, we've seen Lagertha fight for many, many things, Catherine, and most recently she tragically lost the battle to save her daughter's life. So, what will she fight for in season 2?
Oh, wow. What will she fight for? There's so much. My course is so great at writing and evolving our characters and enriching us. There's so many, what I can say, I don't know how much I'm allowed to say. Someone made me dance.
Michael will leap over and stop me.
Who she is, being a strong shield maiden, and that's who she is as a core, so in terms of her personality, and definitely her relationship with Bjorn is tested. Obviously her relationship with Ragnar, and where, since there is a time cut, which, since we know our son is now older, so it would be interesting to see what life brought to her and how, if she is different or if she's stronger and weaker in that situation. But I do say with all the strong female fan base there, I'm in love with Lagertha, and it's been such an honor to kind of make her as strong as possible.
And it'll be interesting to see her more mature. Now, Clive, I'm going to give this question to you. This is a fan question from, it looks like, Raspberry World. Because you seem like a fun guy. So what are the days on set like, and how do you spend your free time during filming?
Wow. I have 3 children, so I have to make up for the time I spend away. So there's a lot of time I'm kind of either flying back to see them or they're on set. So I spend a lot of time getting down on the carpet playing cars and dressing up as princesses.
Playing princesses?
I'm a warrior princess.
You play a warrior shield maiden?
She's a princess.
Did Catherine give you some tips on like maybe some shield
maiden? She's a shield maiden. She can't dress up as a princess unless she's got a shield and a sword in her hand.
How old are your kids?
I've got a 10-year-old boy, Hayden, and then my daughter, Edie, who's 7, and then I've got a little cave boy, who's 3. But together as a cast, we have so much to do in Ireland. We authentic, and obviously we go out drinking because it's the best country in the world to do that. But we've got a place called the 40 Foot, which is just outside Dublin, which is we can dive off into the Irish Sea, so we'll all go swimming, and it's just an incredible place to go hiking and do all those kind of things. I hope to do a bit of scuba diving as well.
So who's the biggest drinker?
Oh. No comment.
All right. Okay. Jesselyn, where's Sadie's love life going in season two? Will she have one?
I don't know if I've got a love life, but she definitely's going to be busy. Sorry, Clive. Well, I just learned about the children, so. It's always fun to hear your colleagues talk about their roles because, you know, it's always sort of enlightening, you know. We watch the show as fans as well. And, you know, one of the things I really love about Siggy is these guys are all the next generation. You know, these guys are all, you know, like Catherine and I have some great things this year because, you know, because of Ragnar stepping out on her and she's, obviously, their emotional attachment is, their love is so pure and it's so devastating to her. And it's been so interesting because I think Siggy's got a kind of, you know, she's from an older order and it's kind of like, girlfriend, what do you think? I mean, he's a girl, that's what they do. And so it's just, it's a completely different perspective where these guys are sort of, or have all this hope and all this ambition, and then so their relationship to love is even so different and their expectations of it. And so far I haven't seen that Siggy really believes in a romantic love anymore. And relationships are opportunities. And so that's what I've seen so far. Is she capable of true love again?
That's what you've been playing?
Oh. Except I really love her a little bit. Yeah, so it's kind of sad because everybody else does have this. I do think that she loves Rollo, but I think that she will always stay, or so far has stayed in control of her emotions because there's just no way she's going to make herself vulnerable the way I think some of this new generation of the Lothbroks do.
Well, speaking of going back many Viking generations, Gustav, you are the only cast member who is all Viking. You are Swedish. So, when you were growing up, how was that Viking legacy depicted in school or society? Was that part of your education?
Yeah, like we do get to, like in school, we get to know like the gods and all that stuff. However, I think like a lot of our Viking heritage is just something that we take for granted, you know, is what we are. So like there's a bigger deal about the Viking legacy like in Ireland than it is in Sweden. You know, if you go to like the tourist street, yeah sure you'll find like a plastic hat with horns on it, even in Stockholm. But there's plenty more of that in Ireland, really. Because I think like it's what we are, it's what we come from, it's our history. You know? And we do study it, but I think like the biggest legacy now it's just us, you know, it's in our language, it's in our genetics. You know, it's just a part of our culture. It's, you know, whenever we celebrate Christmas, there used to be an old pagan tradition. Midsummer, we still like keeping the same traditions, but now it's like under Christian banners, so to speak.
Right. Well, George, you had to do a bit more preparation because you are not Swedish. But for season one, you personally visited Lindisfarne Abbey, where Athelstan was actually kidnapped and raided, the actual spot. What did you do in preparation for season two? How did you prep for that?
To be honest, I tried very hard to grow a beard. I've been doing some Viking stuff this year, and training. Athel Stan's been doing
some
fight training, yeah.
Oh, really?
Who knows what for? But, yeah. And I'd say it's my first television series that I'm a part of, and probably the biggest challenge I found this year is, like, as a teenager growing up, you watch American television series and you kind of binge watch it if you can, and the end of season one finishes and you just click next and watch the start of season two, and it's exactly where it was left off, and you don't think when you're watching it, they've had, those actors or the creative team have had 7 or 8 months between seasons, and it's a really interesting thing for an actor to pick up a character after 8 months off and really get right back into that role. It's especially if the characters are on an arc, like most of them are that Michael's written, where, you know, they're in such stages of development and change. It's really a good, fun challenge to kind of wrestle with that and get your head around that. I'd say that's probably.
So you did the fighting preparation, so we will see Athel Stan perhaps doing some new moves.
Some new moves.
Okay, well, in addition to some new moves for Athel Stan, we have some new locations, don't we? Can you tell us about any of the production locations that are different or sets that are different?
I mean, there's been quite a few this year. The locations have had a really good fun time. Mostly, they found them in Ireland as well. They just keep discovering all these new places that never knew existed. There was this amazing quarry. I'm not going to say what it was for, but they found this amazing. I didn't actually go. You guys went. Maybe you should talk about it. But there's an amazing, massive quarry that we filmed this big sequence in. This year as well is the first time, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, but we're taking the Viking ship out on the ocean, the Irish Sea. Usually before we've had it in a car park with a green screen on a gimbal.
And on a lake
on still water, but it's actually on Monday, isn't it? We fly back Sunday and on Monday we're going out on the ocean. We're all a bit terrified.
That is very exciting, though, that those are seaworthy. You can actually take them out of the ocean. Yeah. That's incredible.
More ships this year as well. We've got a lot more ships.
More ships.
Yeah.
So we'll see you guys out on the water a lot, quite a bit. More raiding, correct? A lot of raiding. Ragnar is alive with someone who's much stronger now. He has more resources, right, Travis?
Yeah.
We've been very lucky. We have a lot more boats this year, and there'll be a lot more ocean sailing, which we're all excited for, except for the monk. The Skylar stuff has really evolved this year. The show's just going to get better and better, and I'm very excited.
Well, I know the audience is excited to ask some questions, so I know we have some audience questions. So when it's your turn to come up to the mic, if you could just let us know your name, and then let us know who the question is for, we can't wait to hear from you. Hi there.
Hi.
I'm Joelle, and I just wanted to ask Clive, if Rollo, you described him as a sociopath, which I have to agree with. So in that vein, if he understood English, if Rollo and Dexter met, what would they say to each other?
If they met?
Yes.
Not a lot. The axe is involved, I think.
So mostly action.
It'll be over very quickly.
Hi, my name is Elizabeth, and I have a question for the gentleman actors. How long did it take you to grow your facial hair?
I'm a big fan of the facial hair. I think that's a great.
And what do your families and friends think of all that?
Who wants to take that one?
who plays Jarl Borg, was sat next to me, and she said, "Torbjörn, how long did it take to grow a beard?" And he's got a beard, like, out here. And he was like, "2 months." And she said, "Oh, George, how long did it take you?" And I was like, "About the same."
Travis, do you want to tell us about the Oh, look, I had a beard before this show, so I'm happy about it. I'm not a dresser upper or nothing like that. My publicist got me this shirt and I have to wear it. I think it just adds so much to me. It's so funny. Certain way, and I'm going to be clean cut, and I'm sure it's so good that it keeps the reality involved, you know. So, we're Vikings, man.
Okay, great. Next.
I'm a really big fan of Norse mythology, and you start off the season with a little bit of a supernatural thing. Are you starting season 2 with that, or are you going to bring that back a little bit?
So, Michael, I think that would be.
Well, the real answer to that is it's actually not supernatural. What you see early on in the show is Odin briefly, and the Valkyries briefly. But in fact, it's not you that's seeing them, it's the Vikings. And in the sagas, we learn that that is exactly what Vikings saw on the battlefield, amongst all the ravens pecking at the dead bodies. They saw Odin moving among the dead bodies, choosing the slain warriors who would go to Valhalla. So it's real. And let me put it to you another way. If I was writing a script about Jesus, and I showed the tomb in which the crucified body was lying, and then Jesus came to life, is that supernatural? No, it's for Christians, it's real. It actually happened. And so everything in the show is actually real, but I don't want to press that too much, because people would then begin to think that I was exploring supernatural things. So I think occasionally I'm going to remind the audience of what is happening in the minds of the Vikings. So we have glimpses of the god, but the gods were also shapeshifters to the Vikings. In other words, they could appear in other guises. So if you see certain animals, they could be gods as well. So a raven could be Odin, or the gods could Loki turned into a flea and a fly and a squirrel and all sorts of things. So to Vikings, the landscape was alive with their gods. The gods walked among them. So that's the only thing I'm reflecting, but this is real to them.
I'm kind of a Viking myself and my relatives, and this has really opened my eyes to my past. For the cast members, you all rock. My question is, if you could raid today as Vikings, or if the Vikings were real, and you guys were it, except for the crazy one over there, we know what you do. Find it worth it, or do you think they'd
kind of
pick up their
I'd go
to San Diego.
So anybody find anything worth raiding here in the contemporary world? Clive?
Well, I haven't been walking around the floor in there. There's a lot of stuff I like already. I'm just like a kid in a candy shop.
So watch out, San Diego. The Vikings are coming.
Hi, I'm Jean. And my question, if I can bring it up on my phone, is actually first I wanted to say that I really appreciated the respectful and beautiful portrayal of a non-Christian religion. And you rarely see this anywhere, and especially in how it was done in the sacrifice episode. And I wanted to know if we're going to explore that more in season two and see more of the clash between Christianity and their religion. Michael?
Well, thank you very much. And yes, absolutely. That's the very essential.
So my question is for Travis and Catherine and sort of George, but the whole panel can pitch in. So we all know that Ragnar and Lagertha had a special offer for Axel. If Ragnar and Lagertha could open up that offer to any modern person, who would it be?
Great question.
Travis?
Up for her, if you know. still got George, it's always open.
You know, I think with Lagertha, I'm not sure if
you'll do what I say.
In other words, would she cheat on Ragnar? I'm not sure, and that's always been a question of mine when I read the first season script when we invited Athelstan. So there's always, it's a question. Was she teasing? Was she actually serious? And,
no, yeah. It's not cheating if I'm watching.
Okay, hi.
My name is Henrik. I'm a Dane. And my question is, your character built the boat. The question I have is, how come you put the steerboard on the port side instead of the steerboard?
This is, might be a shocking reveal to everyone. I didn't actually know.
I think, in all fairness, it does change. We have to get the cameras on one side of the boat at a time, so we have to get the changes to each side. So that's probably the reason why sometimes when you see it on screen, it's on the other side, just because we've got a whole lot of cameras on one side of the boat.
It was always on the right side.
Hi. First of all, George, your beard is fine. Don't worry. And my question is for Catherine and Jocelyn. In the first season, there were a lot of really emotional moments for the women. What was the most emotional for you personally? Wow.
I guess for me, you know, I think Michael definitely put me through the ringer in the first season, especially in the 9th episode, the finale. And I think there's a lot of questions you ask as a woman, for example, losing a child. Or hopefully never will, but I think that that's, and the fact that her relationship is tested, and it's a really hard question to answer, because there's a lot of personal struggles, and every time you dive into a new character, you find out more about yourself, and you do a lot of soul searching, and you do a lot of looking inside, and I can't necessarily single out one thing, but if anything, it was a challenge for me, definitely, to play like that.
I just went.
we both lost our babies, and I never want to film that scene again. That was really tough, for sure.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Natalie, and this is a question for the whole cast, for Michael, whoever wants to answer it. We know that there's going to be a large time jump in the second season, and I was wondering whether that's going to happen immediately, or whether a lot of things happen in the 8th and 9th episodes, and I wonder whether there'll be an episode dealing with all of that, the emotional implications of that.
I don't know whether to tell you. well, what I would say is that, you know, I left a lot of cliffhangers at the end of episode 9, which I thought was incredibly clever of me. Because I thought they'd just have to commission a second season. So, the answer in a way is that those were immediate issues or issues that needed a fairly immediate resolution, and that has to happen before we move forward in time.
Great question. Hi,
my name is Steve. I noticed that with a lot of Viking shows, and this is not just this show, but like all Viking shows, Vikings are always portrayed as these gigantic, tall people. And, you know, you see people like Clive and Gustav, and you know, they're intimidating. They're very intimidating. In the future, are we ever going to get to see like a 5'5" Viking? Because I'm Swedish, and we do have the size.
Actually, that's not totally fair because a lot of the Viking group they were a mixture. We had small Vikings. We had they weren't all. I mean, what we wanted to do was to avoid the obvious cliche that they would look like some, you know, rowing eggs from Harvard or something. They were a very mixed group. They look like real men.
Yes, they do. Yes, they do. Hi,
my name is Kaylee, and my question is geared towards Catherine and Travis. When Geeta died, you know, Ragnar and Rollo are still away. I wanted to know, like, how he is going to handle her passing, and how Catherine, you know, your character is going to, you know, help Ragnar through that.
Help him.
Yeah, I'll find out next season.
Right.
And, yeah, we definitely have a lot of problems with that. But that's just women in general. Sorry, my relationships. No, the biggest loss. I'm sorry, but when you lose a kid, I don't think it's that's the biggest issue. I mean, we can work out our stuff, you know, have sex with her. We got to deal with the kid dying. So I don't.
And losing for lack of losing two children, losing the son of Ragnar and boy and Shipping would be a boy, and Geeta, I think that's tough for anyone, and especially doing on our own and dealing with the sickness of the village and dealing with a lot when he's away and having that responsibility. And it'd be interesting. It does pick off. I don't know what you can say. Those so questions will be answered. It does get answered.
We have time for one more question. This will be the last question.
Hey, that's me. I love you guys. I love you all. I love you, Travis, and Catherine, and Clive. This one's for you. In one of the episodes portraying the iconic shield wall, you gave this amazing war chant. And it was given in English, as I recall. Did you ever try doing that in any of the Viking languages? Danish, Swedish, anything old?
No, that was never written in the Old Norse. I think it was actually cut from the script at one point. And
it was an original.
Partly because it's so beautiful. Yeah, if you just do it in subtitles, most of our audience would have missed it. You know, wouldn't have appreciated it. So I made this decision to do it in English so people could see how beautiful it was and how moving, you know.
Yeah, Do you remember it? Can you do it now?
Up into the overturned keel, climb out with a heart of steel, cold is the ocean spray, and you're dead!